Good afternoon. My name is Jose David Saldivar, and I am the director of the Center for Comparative Studies in Race and Ethnicity, and a professor in the Department of Comparative Literature. And I'm delighted and excited to welcome all of you to this year's Anne and Loren Kieve's Distinguished Lecture. As you know, our CCSRE Kieve Lecture Series tend to be an event in our field at Stanford. The field being not only comparative studies of race and ethnicity in America, but also multiracial studies impinging on America and the world. The Kieve lectures have impact, they create and cause discussion, and provoke debates, and of course, all great things that we like to do. Each year, our center brings to Stanford a notable scholar, writer, or public intellectual, sometimes they're all in the same person, to deliver a lecture pertaining to vital issues relating to race, ethnicity, and culture abroad. The Anne and Loren Distinguished Speakers Fund endow this lecture. Anne and Loren hope that the lecture will help us think through public issues related to the place and space of ethnicity, culture, and race. I'm delighted that Anne and Loren Kieve and their guests are joining us this afternoon, and I'd like for them to stand and so we can acknowledge them. Over the past 9 years, we've assembled a range of thinkers, writers, and artists to address the problems and challenges of cross-racial multiculture. And today, the Anne and Loren Kieve Distinguished Lecture is, I believe, one of the most prestigious lectures at Stanford University. Our past speakers have included Drs. Lonnie Bunch, Melissa Lacewell, Glenda Carpio, Larry Bobo, Claude Steele, Lonnie Guinier, and Gerald Torres, as well as the Pulitzer Prize-winning authors N. Scott Mamaday and Juno Diaz. And today's Kieve speaker is the multi-award-winning writer, and as we heard earlier today, the great artist, Maxine Hahn Kingston, who once wrote, quote, "I learned to make my mind large as the universe is large, so that there is room for paradoxes." And all of her wonderful books are composed of such paradoxes. I'd now like to introduce our moderator, my colleague, Paula Moya. And after I introduce her, she will come and introduce our speaker. Paula Moya is Associate Professor of English and, by courtesy, Iberian and Latin American Cultures. And she's the Director of the Modern Thought and Literature Program, MTL. Previously, Paula Moya was a director of the undergraduate program in CCSRE, so she's had a long affiliation with our center. And she is presently the editor with Professor Hazel Rose Marcus of the book series entitled Stanford Studies in Comparative Race and Ethnicity, published by Stanford University Press. She is the author of Learning from Experience, Minority Identities and Multicultural Struggles, published by the University of California Press in 2002, and she's co-edited 3 books of original essays, the first called Doing Race, 21 Essays for the 21st Century, that she co-edited with Professor Marcus, published by W.W. Norton in 2010, and Identity Politics Reconsidered, published by Palgrave in 2006, and the third entitled Reclaiming Identity, Realist Theory and the Predicament of Postmodernism. Professor Moya is finishing a book entitled The Social Imperative, Race, Close Reading, and Contemporary Literary Criticism. And as I said, it's a real honor for me to introduce Paula and to welcome Maxine Hahn Kingston to Stanford.
It gives me great pleasure to be here with all of you today and to have the honor of introducing the speaker for this year's Kieve lecture. Maxine Hahn Kingston walks as a giant among us. She has a... it's true. She has a prodigious talent and a great spirit. She has been a warrior, and she is a pacifist. She is also Chinese American, a feminist, an activist, a woman of color, a healer, an American, a humanist, and of course, an award-winning writer. Most of you know Professor Hong Kingston as the author of The Woman Warrior, Memoir of a Life Girlhood Among Ghosts, published in 1976, and the winner of the National Book Critics Circle Award for Nonfiction. Or perhaps you know her as the author of China Men, published in 1980, and the winner of the National Book Award for Nonfiction. Others of you will have read her first novel, Tripmaster Monkey, his fake book, which came out in 1989 and won the Penn USA West Award for Fiction. Still others will have read her collection of essays, Hawaii One Summer, or her novel, The Fifth Book of Peace. More recently, she has compiled a collection of essays that came out of her healing workshops with war veterans entitled Veterans of War, Veterans of Peace. And she's published a memoir in verse called I Love a Broad Margin to My Life. But did you know that she has been a poet all her life? She has talked about her mother holding her up at the window when she was six so that she could call out a poem to her two grandfathers who were passing in their vegetable wagon below in the street. I love that image, the way it shows her mother encouraging her and facilitating her poetry. The fact that her first poem emerged as an expression of relationality, and the way it embodied an intergenerational transmission of love. That image says a lot about the kind of writer she would go on to become. Professor Hong Kingston has garnered some of the most important awards a writer can receive. She has received a Guggenheim Fellowship, the American Academy of Arts and Letters Award in Literature, the Humanities Medal, which was conferred upon her by President Clinton, and she was also named a Living Treasure of Hawaii by a Honolulu Buddhist church. But she has another honor as well, the honor that every writer truly covets. I speak of the honor of being widely read. In the 1990s, and perhaps still, her books were the most widely taught on college campuses of any living American author. Imagine that. This is the first opportunity that I have had to meet Professor Hong Kingston in person, but her writing has long inspired and encouraged me, and I am in good company. I think of Sandra Cisneros' borrowing of a line from The Woman Warrior for use as an epigraph in her book of poetry, My Wicked, Wicked Ways. The line, "Isn't a bad girl almost like a boy?" I admire Professor Hong Kingston for taking the chaotic, tragic, hard to deal with events and making meaning out of them by putting them through the process of art, by looking full face and by encouraging others, such as the war veterans with whom she has worked, to look full face into the raw human event and then transmute it into something meaningful by pushing it toward form. Professor Hong Kingston helps all of us learn to live in this often painful, yet sometimes beautiful world. I won't delay us any longer, but we'll instead turn over the program to the one we have all come here to listen to today. Please join me in giving a very warm welcome to our honored speaker, Maxine Hong Kingston.
Thank you, Paula, for a wonderful introduction, and thank you, Jose, also. Before I begin, you know there's three seats up front here. That was the one I was sitting in, so for people in back, come on. And there's two seats over there. Yes, it's on. But then my dress looks funny. Okay. Maybe we could put it on this one.
Yes. Yeah. I brought mine. Okay. Let's try that. Okay.
Thank you. Okay. Now it sounds a bit louder, right? I'm going to read to you a paragraph at the beginning of The Woman Warrior, in which I ask some questions that begin my thinking and wording life. Chinese Americans, when you try to understand what things in you are Chinese, how do you separate what is peculiar to childhood, to poverty, insanities, one family, your mother who marked your growing with stories from what is Chinese? What is Chinese tradition and what is the movies? So those are a child's questions, but I've worked on those questions my whole life. And in a way, they guided me to the writings I've done ever since. Now, there's a character that I made up, Whitman Ah Sing. And what he wants to do is, like, he wants to be the first hip Chinese American. And he said that race and ethnicity are low karma problems. And so he doesn't want to address them at all. And so I'm going to read to you a scene in which Whitman brings his white girlfriend, Tanya, to meet his mother. The reason he thought that questions of race and ethnicity are low karma is that it's like equality is self-evident, and so there's not going to be any interesting discourse that's going to come out of it. So I want to show you. See what happens to him when he brings his white girlfriend to meet his mother. Now, I wrote his mother, I made her up as a really cool woman. And her name is Long-Legged Ruby. And the reason she has that name is that she was a showgirl at the Forbidden City in San Francisco. And I made Whitman a fourth and fifth generation American. Fourth generation on his mother's side, fifth on his father's side. And this is my fantasy of escaping from being a FOB. And maybe if he's been in America for so long, there's a chance of being hip and cool. Okay, so here's the scene from the Tripmaster Monkey. Okay, he's just going in through the door, and his mother lives in Sacramento. Through the screen door, the crack, clack, crash of Mahjong. Oh no, Mahjong Day. That's why all those Coupe de Villes to have squeezed a parking space among. The son of the house would have turned about, but for the girl he was with. Always do the harder thing. He opened the door, went ahead, held it for Tanya. Ruby screamed, "Eek!" Stood up and screamed again, pointing. And Auntie Sadie screamed. And Auntie Marlise ran to him. His mother eeked him again. Eek! What's wrong? The white girl? A hobo bumbled in after them. "What have you done to yourself?" She put her hands to her cheeks. "You used to be such a beautiful boy," shouted Auntie Marlise, looking up at him. "Too much hair," said Auntie Sadie. "Much too hairy." "You go shave," said Mother. "Shave it off, shave it off." "Oh, hockey, nay say, that is, scares you to death. Gick say nay, that is, irks you to death, gulls you to death, clack, clack." "No act, Ma," he said. "Don't say hello to your mother," she said. "Never you mind sticks and stones, honey boy," said Auntie Bessie. "Have a heart, Ruby." A dog jumped on him. "Down, Queenie, behave," said Auntie Jadine, its owner. "Where you manners, Queenie?" Those who usually spoke Chinese talked to the yapper dog in English. "Down, Queenie, come here." They spoke English to him and to the dog, American animals. "Good dog," said Whitman. It mind fucks dogs to be called good when they're trying to be fierce. "Whitman has come to see his mama," explained the aunties one to another. "Good boy, big boy now." Clack, 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 a racket of clack, clack, clack. "All grow up, college grad, huh, Whitman?" Nobody asked if he were a doctor or an engineer yet. How tactful. Not asking about work at all. "Sit, sit, sit. Here's an empty chair by me, dearie. Come meet me." Tanya got a side chair at one of the dining tables. "Oh, I be so sorry I didn't recognize you, Whitman," said Auntie Sadie. "You so changed." "That's okay, Auntie Sadie. Come talk to your Aunt Lila." "Hello, Aunt Lila." "Hello, Auntie Dolly," said Whitman. "Hello, Aunt Peggy." He went to each auntie, shaking hands with some, kneeling beside this one and that one for her to take a better look at him. He was a cute baby. Why you not visit Auntie more often?" "Me too, honey boy. Visit you Aunt Sandra too." The ladies called themselves Aunt, and Whitman called them Aunt. "Hair, big city style, isn't it, dear?" said Auntie Dolly of San Francisco, ruffling his hair. "Beard in high style, Ruby. Whitman, big city guy now." The ladies at his mother's table were comforting her. "Hairy face, fashion on a plate," said Auntie Sophie. "You the one sent him to college, Ruby." Clack, clack. "Where I go wrong, I ask you," said Whitman's mother. "He was clean cut. He used to be Sue Mun. That is, he used to be Swagne. He doesn't get his grooming from me." "Kehosu, kegapaya, gumsu, sutak jai. He takes too much after his father. So like, too alike. Mung cha cha, both of them, father and son, mung cha cha. In Hong Kong now, they say MCC, said Auntie Peggy, who was up on the latest. MCC, MCC. The aunties tried the new Hong Kong slang. Mung cha cha means spacey, spaced out and having to grope like a blind man. Meanwhile, at Tanya's table, Aunt Dolly, who was sophisticated, was saying, "What's your name, honey?" "Tana, what a pretty name." "Russian? Do you play, Tana? I'll show you how to play. This is a very famous Chinese game, mahjong. Can you say mahjong?" Auntie Dolly had been a showgirl in New York and knew how to endear herself to foreigners. She did introductions. Good. Whitman did not want to announce Tanya to the room, and he was not about to table hop with her like a wedding couple. "That's Madam S.Y. Chin. This is Madam Gordon Fong, etc." "Hello," said Tanya. Well, you can't expect her to say, "How do you do, madam?" And if she said, "How you do, Mrs.," the lady would feel demoted. Meet Miss Madame Wadsworth Wu. "How do you do, Wu?" "Madam to you." "Madam, shit. Madam Chiang Kai-shek. Madam Sun Yat-sen. Madame Charles Jones Sung and T.V. Sung. Madam Nu." All the cookbook ladies are madams. And all the restaurant guys are generals. Generalissimo. "Let me show you how to play, honey." "Don't trust anybody who calls you honey, Tanya. It's a verbal tic." "My name is Maydene Lam," said Auntie Maydene. "Call me Maydene, dear." "How do you do, Maydene?" "I've always liked your name," said Auntie Lily Rose. "Such a pretty stage name, Maydene Lam. Isn't it delicious? There are four little girls named after me in the valley. Clickety-clackety. What beautiful hair you have, Tanya." "She's gorgeous, Whitman," yelled Aunt Dolly. "You are so fair." "Isn't she fair?" "Thank you," said Tanya, who hadn't yet learned that compliments need to be denied and returned. Every auntie had jet black hair. Why do women, as they get older, have to have fixed hair? Because of beauty fixed at 1945. These were the glamour girls of World War II, taking after the Sung sisters and Anna Chenault, who married guys in uniform. Whenever the auntie's pictures appeared in the papers, Chinese or English, they were identified as the lovely Madam Houston W.P. Fong, the beauteous Madam Johnny Tom. They were professional beauties. To this day, the old judges vote for the Miss Chinatown USA, who most reminds them of these ladies. Quite a few of them had been Wongettes. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Eddie Pond proudly welcomes to the Kublai Khan the beautiful Wongettes, Chinese blondes in a blue mood. "Myself, I am a blonde at heart," said Auntie Dolly. "Don't you look askance at her, Tanya, with your sanpaku eyes, or else I'm getting a divorce. Chow, pung, kong, action. 8 10,000s, mahjong, clack, clack, mahjong." "Whitman, over here," said Ruby. "Coming, mother," said Whitman. He stood behind her to look at her winning hand. "Talk to Sinai here," said the mother. "You enjoying the game, Sinai?" he said to the lady, whom he had never met before. "Oh, how well behaved," said the Sinai, the lady. "So Doc Yi, and such good manners. Most boys with beards are bumhow." "He doesn't have to call me Sinai. You call me Auntie Whitman." His mother spoke sotto voce in Chinese. "Who's the girl?" "My friend, a good friend," he said in English. "One shouldn't speak a foreign language in front of people who don't understand it, especially when talking about them. Don't add to the paranoia level of the universe." "Serious?" "Sure. How serious?" "Serious, okay." Gary Snyder had gone to Japan to meditate for years and could now spend 5 minutes in the same room with his mother. Beat his record. "So you walk with her," said Auntie Sophie. She was translating "go with her." She meant, "so you go with her." "Mixing with girls," teased Auntie Marlise. "Old enough to mix the girls." "Go after girls with an egg beater." "She's so rude. She's not talking to me," said Mom. "She's hurt my feelings, Whitman." "Introduce you gal to you mama, young man," said Auntie Sophie. Clack. "Hey, Tanya," he called over to her table. "Meet my mother, Ruby Ah Singh. Ma, meet my Pang Yao, Tanya." Pang Yao means friend. Maybe Tanya would think it meant wife. Hi, Tanya waved, click. You aren't growing up to be a heartbreaking man, are you, honey boy? Said Auntie Lila. Speak for your own self, said back-talking Whitman. She was a glamour girl, still raising hell at 75. She gets you alone for a moment, she'll confide her romance. Honey, this entree news is on the QT and must go no further than this very room. My beloved is a Saiyan. He's 55 years old and so distinguished. All his clothes are Brooks Brothers. My Saiyan lover is offering to divorce his wife for me, but I don't want to be married. Monday, Wednesday, and Friday are enough. A Saiyan is a Western man, which isn't correct. We're Westerners too. UC, state-run public school, does not teach them to present themselves socially, Auntie Jeannie was explaining. She was an authority on higher education. A son at Harvard, a daughter at Wellesley, where the Sung sisters who married Sun Yat-sen went, another son at Princeton, the baby daughter at Sarah Lawrence. As I said to Mei Ling Soon, Ivy League, the A number one all around. They learn how to make money and they learn to go around in society. Very complete. The cruel thing to say back to her is, what eating club does Ransford belong to? But you don't want to be mean to her. They will graduate and never come back. At UC, this one learned, grow hair long, Mom agreed. Grow rat beard and go out with Bakwai Noi. As if dating Las Gringas wasn't his idea. He had to be taught. You ought to see them there in Berkeley. Doi doi check, yut doi yao yut doi. Pair after pair of mixed couples. Check, an article used with livestock. Doi, an article used with poultry. You meet my Whitman too late, Sinai. You missed out on one good-looking boy. You still got one matinee idol under the hair, Ruby, said Aunt Marlise. Cut it for your poor mother, Whitman. I remember when you were yay high. I used to change his diapers. You were deh, Whitman. He was so deh. Click, click. She gave them an example of deh. Her head to one side, a finger to her dimple, coy lady pose. The aunties smiled at him like he was going to act deh any moment for his mother at least. Do baby talk, act babyish, and bring out motherly love. Cut it off, Whitman, said mother. Cut it off, I'll pay you, clack. Just, said Whitman, just lay off of me. Cut me some slack, let me be. And let me live. I realize it has been so long since I've read this book or thought about it. I realize he had just married her. They're already married, but he can't, he's trying to pass her off as a girlfriend and as a friend. So but I think you got that. Okay, so in Tripmaster Monkey, I'm showing that karma flows down through the generations. And even though the showgirls have this Chinese-American heritage, there's still this, there's all kinds of race and ethnicity things going through them. Those women, even though I think they thought they were being really modern and they were going to break out of this stuffy middle class or Chinese world by becoming showgirls, actually they are in a lineage of generations of Chinese American theater. The opera troupes came from China to go with the railroad builders, and they entertained them up in the Sierras. And the descendants of those opera companies, the companies and the people continue to this day. And just today, just hours ago, at noon Eastern time in Washington, D.C., the Chinese railroad workers were inducted into the Labor Hall of Honor. This is the first recognition of the Chinese railroad workers. So in honor of all that, I'm going to read to you some sections of the grandfather in the Sierra Nevada mountains. This is my grandfather, and we called him Agung. And the first thing he does when he's up in the Sierras was that he encounters the beauty of the place. The days were sunny and blue, the wind exhilarating, the heights godlike. At night, the stars were diamonds, crystal, silver, snow, ice. He had never seen diamonds. He had never seen snow and ice. As spring turned into summer and he lay under that sky, he saw the order in the stars. He looks up at the constellations, the Milky Way, and which is the river of heaven in China. And first thing, you know, he is totally so homesick. And of course, he feels so good because it's the same stars, it's the same moon, it's the same sun that the rest of the people he has left behind are seeing. And as he looks up there, he tells to himself the really homesick story of the spinning girl and the cowboy, and they are separated by the river of heaven. But once a year, the magpies fly over and make a bridge, and they can meet once a year. And so since the world is all connected, the magpies are also the birds that are in the Sierras. When he's up there, of course, they're working on the railroad for years, and also time seems to go so slow because you're trying to break through granite with a pickaxe. I want to read about Agung's sense of time. After tunneling into granite for about 3 years, Agung understood the immovability of the earth. Men change, men die, weather changes, but a mountain is the same as permanence and time. This mountain would have taken no new shape for centuries, 10,000 centuries, the world a still, still place, time unmoving. He worked in the tunnel so long, he learned to see many colors in black. When he stumbled out, he tried to talk about time. I felt time, he said. I saw time. I saw world. He tried again. I saw what's real. I saw time, and it doesn't move. If we break through the mountain, hollow it, time won't have moved anyway. You translators ought to tell the foreigners that. And so there he is in, you know, it's just amazing the way history and karma, how it all works. So they're going through the tunnels. They did have gunpowder, but it didn't quite work. And so they were mostly working with pickaxe. And then Alfred Nobel invented dynamite. And so the invention of dynamite happened at the same time as the building of the railroads. And so we get a chance to experiment with dynamite. In the third year of pounding granite by hand, a demon invented dynamite. The railroad workers were to test it. They had stopped using gunpowder in the tunnels after avalanches, but the demon said that dynamite was more precise. They watched a scientist demon mix nitrate, sulfate, and glycerin, then flick the yellow oil, which exploded off his fingers. Sitting in a meadow to watch the dynamite detonated in the open, Agung saw the men in front of him leap impossibly high into the air. Then he felt a shove as if from a giant's unseen hand, and he fell backward. The boom broke the mountain silence like fear breaking inside stomach and chest and groin. No one had gotten hurt. They stood up laughing and amazed, looking around at how they had fallen, the pattern of the explosion. Dynamite was much more powerful than gunpowder. Agung had felt a nudge as if something kind were moving him out of harm's way. All of a sudden, I was sitting next to you. If we had been nearer, it would have killed us. If we were stiff, it would have gone through us. A fist, a hand, we leapt like acrobats. Next time, Agung flattened himself on the ground and the explosion rolled over him. Okay, now there is a myth in our family that the men were lowered from baskets and they would plant the dynamite into crevices. And then they lit it, and then they were hoisted up really fast. And so I have a scene in which Agung goes down in the basket, and this is what happens to him. The men played a little. They rode the baskets swooping in wide arcs. They twisted the ropes and let them unwind like tops. "Look at me," said Agung, pulled open his pants and pissed overboard, the wind scattering the drops. "I'm a waterfall," he said. He had sent a part of himself hurtling. On rare windless days, he watched his piss fall in a continuous stream from himself almost to the bottom of the valley. One beautiful day, dangling in the sun above a new valley, not the desire to urinate, but sexual desire clutched him so hard he bent over in the basket. He curled up, overcome by beauty and fear, which shot to his penis. He tried to rub himself calm. Suddenly, he stood up tall and squirted out into space. "I am fucking the world," he said. The world's vagina was big, big as the sky, big as a valley. He grew a habit. Whenever he was lowered in the basket, his blood rushed to his penis, and he fucked the world. Okay, since I am always very high-minded, what I have in mind here is this is a big metaphor. These China men were not allowed to stay in America. They could not be part of this, and so what I am showing is the marriage of a Chinese man to America, and he's making himself a part of this place. He is an ancestor of this place. As important a contribution as the railroads were, I do not think that they were the most important contribution. The big contribution that these men made was to change labor law. The strike on the railroad is the this was their working for the labor rights. Imagine the bravery of these people. They had no rights. They were not citizens, and they could not be citizens. They were coolies, and yet they organized the laborers, and they went on strike for the rights of the working man. I'm going to read to you just a little, a couple of scenes from the strike. The strike began on Tuesday morning, June 25th, 1867. The men who were working at that hour walked out of the tunnels and away from the tracks. The ones who were sleeping slept on and rose as late as they pleased. They bathed in streams and shaved their mustaches and wild beards. Some went fishing and hunting. The violinists tuned and played their instruments. The drummers beat their instruments at the punchlines of jokes. The gamblers shuffled and played their cards and tiles. The smokers passed their pipes, and the drinkers bet for drinks by making figures with their hands. The cooks made party food. The opera singers' falsettos almost perforated the mountains. The men sang new songs about the railroad. They made up verses and shouted ho at the good ones and laughed at the rhymes. Oh, they were madly singing in the mountains. The storytellers told about the rise of new kings. The opium smokers, when they roused themselves, told their florid images. Ah Gong sifted for gold. All the while, the English-speaking China men, who were being advised by the shrewdest bargainers, were at the demon's headquarters, repeating the demand. 8 hours a day, good for white man. All the same, good for China man. They had probably negotiated the demons down to 9-hour shifts by now. The sounds of hammering continued along the tracks, and occasionally there were blasts from the tunnels. The scabby white demons had refused to join the strike. 8 hours a day, good for white man, all the same good for China man, the Chinaman explained to them. Cheap John Chinaman, said the demons, many of whom had red hair. The Chinamen scowled out of the corners of their eyes. Oh, I realize here that I'd say that my grandfather panned for gold. Actually, he found some, and he had it made into this ring, which I am wearing now. and so later you could come up and look at it. So he did bring something back. Okay, so then I'm going to skip to the last day of the strike. The strike ended on the ninth day. The Central Pacific announced that in its benevolence, it was giving the workers a $4 raise. Not the $14 they had asked for, and that the shifts in the tunnels would remain 8 hours long. We were planning to give you the $4 raise all along, the demons said, to diminish the victory. So they got $35 a month and the 8-hour shift. They would have won $45 if the 1,000 demon workers had joined the strike. Demons would have listened to demons. The China men went back to work quietly. No use singing and shouting over a compromise and losing 9 days' work. I get to the end of the building of the railroad, and then I have a scene where they're jumping and laughing and shouting, and then I had a little scene here during the strike when they're telling stories and they're telling jokes and they're laughing. I really make it a point to show that they could laugh, and that they could laugh, because even as I was writing this book, which was in the 70s, beginning of the 80s, there was still the stereotype that Asians don't have a sense of humor, that Orientals don't laugh. You know, I mean, that was just very. That was just something that was out there in the air. So this is why I just really made it a point to say that that they could laugh. Okay, so then today I wrote a haiku for the day, and here's how it goes. At 11 a.m., Agung entered the Labor Hall of Fame. No, that's not it. I got it wrong. I'm so used to saying, you know. At 11 a.m., Agung entered the Labor Hall of Honor. Okay, so after the railroads and the driving out, as soon as their labor was not needed, there were pogroms all over the country, and burnings of Chinatown and lynchings and just getting rid of them. And then the exclusion laws kept getting rid of people until the 60s even. And so all my life, I have live with this fear of being deported because we're illegal, and actually this fear of being deported could also accounts for why I write the way I do. China Men and Woman Warrior, is that fiction or is that nonfiction? Nobody can tell, and I liked it that way. I wanted to tell my family stories, but I was afraid that the immigration would read it and then deport all of us. And so I make many versions of how did we get here. But now that both my parents are dead, I'm going to tell you how they really got here. So my father, He got to Cuba, and then he stowed away on a ship from Cuba, and he was hidden in the cargo, and then he got to New York, and he made his way to on deck, and he right away he got caught by immigration, and so they put him in jail for a little bit, and then deported him back to Cuba, and right away he got on another ship. And then he made his way to New York again, and right as he was trying to get off, they got him again, and they deported him again, and then he got on another ship, and it's just like a fairy tale, you know, the third ship, and he gets to New York, and this time he made it, and he got off. And he's running toward Chinatown because that's where he can find refuge, and then as he was going, he saw a newspaper, and it said that Lindbergh had just landed in Paris, and my father just jumped into the air and he said, "We did it!" It's like, you know, can you see the kind of hero that he felt himself to be, that he and Lindbergh were the same kind of person. You know, that adventure, the exploration. Okay, so then he spent, let's see, he washed windows on Fifth Avenue. He had a laundry. He was a gambler. And So one day he was gambling with all his friends, and this is like, this is 15 years after he's left China, and they are gambling and gambling for money and somehow my father won like $600 from this man named Jack Hong, and so then Jack thinks, well, I can't pay you. I don't have the money. And you know what my father said? He said, give me your wife's visa. And so he won a visa for my mother to come to China. I mean, come to America, to leave China. And he, so that's how my mother came. And this man's name is Jack Hong. So our fake name and our real name are the same. and I mean, don't you wonder what happened to Jack and when his wife found out? Okay, so that's why, you know, our whole lives we're illegal aliens, and we always kept thinking we're going to be deported, and so it's just really weird. Like, we can't call ourselves undocumented aliens because we were so documented. I mean, all our papers, all fake papers, and those papers work really well because both my brothers got top security clearance when they were in the military. And also working at the Lawrence Radiation Lab, they got top security clearance, so we know we have good papers. But my parents just didn't believe that. So, you know, it really makes a difference. If I were writing that story now, after they're dead, I would be writing a very different story. Okay, so I am going to end by, I guess in a way this is a story that just pulls all of our migrations and immigrations together. This is a story about how people are still coming. And not just from China, but everywhere, all over the world. We're all moving, we're all coming here. And so this is a story about how I got to accompany somebody as she crosses borders. This is part of my long poem, which I call "A Love, a Broad Margin to My Life." This is a quote from Henry David Thoreau. He said, "I love a broad margin to my life." And you know, by knowing Thoreau's life, how he liked to be living away from the main population, so he could be in nature, and so he can live deliberately and have a good perspective on how human beings are. But even when he is away in Walden Pond, far away in the woods, he hears music playing, and it's martial music, brass band and drums. And he says, "I am hearing my neighbors getting ready to go to war with Mexico." So you see, hear how the reverberations of that last to this day. This is why he refused to pay his taxes, and this is why he went to jail, because he did not want his taxes to go toward our going to war against Mexico. So when he says, "I love a broad margin to my life," margin also means borders, the crossing of borders, the being in borders. Once I was on an airplane beside a village girl in the window seat. At takeoff, I asked her, "Where are you going?" "Wah!" she shouted in surprise and grabbed a hold of my hand. "You speak like me." "Yes, I speak Sayup language." "Are you from the village?" "No, my mama and papa came from Sayup villages. They left for New York. They lived in New York, then California. I was born in California." I feel like a child, younger than this girl. I'm telling about parents as if I still had them. I'm talking in my baby language. "Wah!" she exclaimed, loud as though yelling across fields. "I am going to New York. I am meeting my husband in New York. He's waiting for me in New York. He works in a restaurant. He's rented a home. He sent for me and waits for me." She did not let go of my hand. I held hers tightly as we flew the night sky. She looked in wonder at webs of lights below. "Red, red, green, green," she said. "Red, red, green, green," my mother used to say, meaning, "Oh, how pretty." The lights were white and yellow too, and gold, blue, copper, and above, stars and stars. "Mother, mama, as you leave the village family you'll never see again." Grandfather walked her as far as he could walk, stood weeping in the road until she could not see him anymore when she turned around to look. "She's off to that lonely country from where he returned broke." I felt that I was dying. "Mama, girl, you are not traveling alone. I am traveling with you here, holding your hand. I know that country you're leaving for and shall guide you there. I know your future. I'm your child from the future. Your husband will meet you. Baba will be at the East Broadway station. You will recognize each other, though he be dressed modern Western style. You will have a good, good life. You will have many children and live a long, long life. You will be lucky. You are lucky." I'm talking to the girl now. "You are lucky. Your husband has work. He's rented an apartment and made you a home. He saves money. He bought your plane ticket. He will be waiting for you at the airport." She listened to the wise old woman teaching her. But how to instruct anyone the way to make an American life? How to have a happy marriage? For a long time in the dark, dozing, dreaming, thinking, we sat without speaking, without letting go of warm hands. The red, red, green, green appeared again. I told her, "That's Japan. We're going over Japan now. We'll be landing soon in Narita." "Wah! You speak Japanese too." She admires me too much. Inside the horrible confusion of the international airport, how can a mind from the village not fall to crazy pieces? I found a nice American couple making the connecting flight to New York and asked them please to take this Chinese girl to the right gate. She thanked me. She said, "Goodbye. See you again, Joy Kin." She did not look back. "Good. Gotta go. Things to do, people to meet, places to be."
Thank you. thank you so much for those wonderful readings of your books and for touching on so many of the issues that have motivated you over the years. I am going to ask a question that just occurred to me while you were talking. I have lots of questions, and I'm going to ask one, and the reason I'm going to ask that is to give you all an opportunity to get your questions sort of queued up. I'll ask another one if we don't find somebody to ask a question, but I'm just sort of giving you a moment because this often takes a little bit of a time. But you both write about and have talked about your method in terms of listening to the stories that your mother told you and how you took those stories and you made them yours. And then, of course, so a woman warrior came out of your mother, your mother's stories, your aunt's stories, and the two aunts, Famulan, right? You know that ancestor, and you brought them, and you made them yours. And then you wrote China Men, which was your grandfather's story, and these are wonderful. But as you were talking, and especially because you said at some point you referenced a myth, and you said there was a myth in my family, this is kind of weird. But do you do research at all for your books? Because that I haven't heard you talk about. So, and if you do, what kind of research do you do to fill out your books?
I do very little research. I have done some research in order to verify some of the talk story. And as an example, I write about the China men in Alaska, and there was a driving out in which they were put on a leaking ship. A leaking boat, and I can't remember, maybe 100 of them, they were putting on a leaking boat and sent out to sea. And I think, wow, I mean, you hear this in talk story, and the research is that I go to the libraries and I find evidence or news of this event. Well, what I found were diaries, I found newspaper things, and what I learned was that even though this is documentation, this is written supposedly evidence, all the information is different. They were saying, well, the Indians did it, and they named the tribe, which Indians, and they were wearing their war bonnets the way it was done. There's one that it was a rainy, sad day when this happened. And then another one, it was a bright, sunny July day. And they don't have the dates right. They don't have the weather right. And I thought, you know, documentation is just as reliable as talk story. And all the talk story, I would find I would always find some kind of written information that would help. And of course, dates, I looked those up. But even, you know, one thing that bothered me, like, how could a person of my age, I'm 73, how could I have a grandfather who was a working railroad in 1865. A lot of people in my family lived to be 100. Okay, so you can work it out that way. I found out that the average Chinese who came through Angel Island was 16. I mean, these were boys that were sent out to do labor. And then another way, you know, when my family talks story, they don't have dates, but then they would say somebody was born in the year of the tiger, or they don't put it that way. They say he was a tiger, or he was a rabbit, and so that way I look up the the dates, and that gives me 12 years leeway.
So I'm wondering if you might talk a little bit about the work that you've done with veterans and what motivated you to do that, and what that added to your life, as well as what you think it might have helped for them.
This all started with the Berkeley Oakland Hills fire, which was 20 years ago now, and I was working on a book of peace, and I had heard that that in China there were 3 books of peace, and they were all lost, and so I thought, well, I am going to write a book of peace for our time, and. And so when this fire came through, it burned the house and the whole neighborhood, the forest, the 3,000 houses, and it burned my writing also. And so after the fire, how will I start to create again? And so I was working on this book about how to make peace in this world, and you know. When I'm teaching writing, I always recommend that the students find a writing community, that you have a writing partner. So there's always somebody that you work with that encourages you. So I thought, you know, I've been working alone all these years. Why don't I get a community of writers for myself, and let them be war veterans, because here's people who will have they will deal with the hardest questions of how to arrive at peace. And so I gathered all these veterans from all over and from all kinds of wars and riots and big disturbances and including gang members who consider themselves veterans. And we've been writing together for 20 years. And during that time, the idea is to make community, and because my idea is that when they're at war and they're coming back with post-traumatic stress disorder, they don't belong anywhere, and so make a community, and then we do Buddhist practices, you know, meditation, all kinds of meditations, and being together in silence, and working with the Buddhist ethics, which is the same as everybody's ethics, but then you work on these commandments which you've broken. So how can we, how do we live after that? Now what do we do? And all this time having a way of expression, which is in the writing, and so we just wrote for. Oh, I guess it was about 15 years, and then by that time, everybody's got a really good body of work, and then we published the book, Veterans of War, Veterans of Peace.
That's wonderful. So
we have a question.
Oh, good. Okay. Yes.
Your work seems to have really opened the door to many, many Chinese American novelists and writers, both male and female. For you, though, when you started writing, who were your models outside of the family? What literary figures or traditions did you turn to?
Well, I think that my biggest hope and influence and inspiration were the African-American writers. I really saw Richard Wright and Ralph Ellison and James Baldwin. They broke through the white publishing establishment mainstream. And so I just followed in that way. Their story would be different from mine, but I they can do it. I don't really feel that I opened the door to their writing. I think that they are already writing. Their stories are already coming from them, and they are creating. But how to get into the publishing, that blindness where they don't see the stories coming from other people. At the beginning, I mean, I know the Black writers are out there, but they don't know about me. And so I thought if I couldn't get published in America, I would send my work to London or to Hong Kong. For some reason, I thought, I mean, these are English speaking, these people know the English language. Maybe they will just purely look at it in terms of language. But it worked out really well that I did get published in America. But even then, time of getting your work out there was not easy. Even as late as Tripmaster Monkey, Amy Tan came out with her second book, I think, at that time. And the reviewers, they would just review one of us, because we got her, and so we don't need to review the other one. And so, and that happened a lot.
Other questions? Yes.
Thank you so much for reading those passages. I was really surprised, actually, by how much I identified and could relate to a lot of those things that you read in all the stories, actually. I'm a graduate student here, but I'm a first-generation Chinese-American. My parents immigrated about 30 years ago from southern China. And I'm curious to know what your thoughts are about the experiences of kind of the current first-generation Chinese-Americans, and how similar or different our experiences are from those of yours. Because just hearing from the stories that you just read, I was really shocked by how similar it reminded me of my family and all the stories they've told me and all that. So thank you.
I find that I'm really surprised at the speed at which the young people, not even the first generation, but the ones who are coming over now, I am just amazed at their ability to survive and thrive. What I'm thinking about is Vietnamese boat people. I mean, here they are on a boat from Vietnam, and then a couple of years in immigration camp, and from one country to another, you know, they're in Thailand, they're in Hong Kong, and then they're in America, and then the next thing you know, they are the valedictorian of their graduating class. I mean, that just amazes me because they have learned another language and they hadn't been in school for years, and all of a sudden to learn all that. And when I compare it to my family, my mother and father, who never really could speak English in a fluent way, and also the attitudes of being people in want and hungry and in need and always so worried about money and about deporting, I
I'm amazed also at seeing the young, illegal, undocumented people go out there on a demonstration and say right to the camera, I'm undocumented and these are the rights I want. Wow, that's so brave. That we did not have in our generation. So I just feel, I am in awe. Oh, but then I'm also, yeah, then there are all those that are in gangs though. Oh, go, I don't want to talk about that.
Long. Yeah, right there.
Thank you so much. Your discussion of your work with the veterans and also the kind of work you were doing in a book like Chinamen makes me think about and want to ask you about whether you consider your engagement with kind of these historical traumas as a process of healing in some way, that when you are writing through these kind of painful episodes of history, that you are engaging in a process of healing. And I thought about when you were saying how important it was for there to be laughter in those scenes and the railroads, about how not only was this pushing against a stereotype of Asians as being humorless, but also to kind of expand the portrait of these people as not just a series of victims of a trauma, but as these living people who had laughter and joy and all these other aspects of their life, as well as being part of something that was historically traumatic. And so I wanted to ask about if you thought your engagement with history is a kind of process of healing, and maybe what are some of the challenges or delicacies of trying to do that through writing?
You know, when I work with the veterans, I never mention that we're healing. I mean, we are not here to heal because, you know, I'm not here to fix you, and we don't know whether you're going to get over this, anything that's wrong with you. I don't claim to heal anybody, nor do I say that writing, which is what the main thing that we do, I do not claim that it's going to get you. I don't claim that you're going to get published. I don't claim that you're ever going to get anything out of it. Nor do I say that it's going to heal you, because heal is it's way down the line. And what we want to work on is what's right here. And I feel that all of us needs to know what happened in history, and all the actual history, the mythic history, because we inherit all of that, and we are living it out, and we mustn't go, and also the all of that history, they are our wealth. We are rich because of that, and we are. That is the karma that we are here to live out and to continue it, or to reconcile it, to learn from it. So all that, of course, all of it goes into making a really good story too, and then when you write stories, of course, you want to write a full person, and a full person also laughs and plays, and I also want to tell all these immigrations. I mean, aren't there some people who just immigrated for the fun of it? I mean, it's not all desperation, I feel that everybody needs to know these things, but it's especially an artist and a writer, you have to do the whole background of all your characters, because we are the latest incarnation of all those people. I wonder whether
the very spare writing that's like a very minimalist writing, language writing, I wonder whether it's like a forgetting history or trying to break away from karma. And so people write all this real modern stuff that doesn't have that rich background. So okay, even though I'd say that this does not, I don't promise healing, actually it does heal. The magic of a shape of a story is that you bring all kinds of problems and conflicts into the story, enemies, you put all those people into the story. And then the climax is when the conflicting forces meet. And there's this big, important, main part of the story and culmination. And then after that, the story always goes toward, throughout, there's more and more understanding, various points of view. And then at the end, there is reconciliation and recognition. Aristotle says the most important thing that we get out of art is recognition. I guess recognition of one another and the humanity in one another, recognition of different parts of yourself, recognition of all of history, all that war that led us to who we are now. By the end of the story, you've got that. And that's the happy ending healing that you want.
So we are coming to the end of our time here. We will continue it with the reception, but I'm gonna take the privilege as the moderator to just ask one simple last question. And that has to do, I mean, it sort of came up earlier, influences. And I've heard you mention now Aristotle, Thoreau, Walt Whitman, Richard Wright. It's a wide range of writers, but I'm wondering, I've always taught you in your work, I think of it, your work, you, always taught you, I always taught your work in the context of a class that I call Writings by Women of Color.
Oh.
I'm wondering, what women writers have been important to you?
Oh, really important is Virginia Woolf's Orlando. And I learned so much from Orlando. First of all, Orlando is a man and turns into a woman, or vice versa, I can't remember now. And and Orlando lives for 400 years. And and also Virginia Woolf is able to tell a whole history of a people in one paragraph, like the history of the gypsies, and she does it in one paragraph. And so I wanted to do that too. I wanted to show people who live for a long time so that all kinds of events happen to them. And I want to know, I want to be able to write from the point of view of a man and of a woman. And so, and she did all of that. And she did such a good job of showing how time goes by. Oh, there's this moment when they move from the 19th century to the 20th. And she described that, just boom, it's like the light changed and the atmosphere changed. And I've done that with, you know, you were asking about when I first published, people don't know about Chinese people and they don't know anything about Chinese American people either. They don't have the history. But I can't spend my whole story giving explication because that's boring and it slows the story down. So I have to figure out a way, how am I gonna do a whole history in just really short and do it without footnotes? That was a big challenge, no footnotes. And Virginia Woolf was able to do all that stuff, so.
Thank you so much. Please join me in thanking.